Good morning, and welcome to Bainbridge United Methodist Church. This Sunday is a part of the Memorial Day weekend, where we remember those who died in active military service. Let us watch a video tribute by our own veteran, Bill Cottrell.
Okay. All right, now, all of you know that I'm Bill, and I've talked to you a lot of years about Memorial Day and our veterans. And the main thing I want to talk to you about, anything of this, is about the veterans. You know, through all the wars that these guys have protected this great country. And yeah, I get a little teary when I think about a lot of them. A lot of them gave their lives. When every man or woman decides they're going to go into service, they're asked if they will pledge their allegiance to this great country and to our great Declaration of Independence. Also, at the same time when they're doing this, they guarantee that they will give up their life for this great country and the people in it. It's hard to say a lot of things because it's just one of those things, folks. If you love your military, you love your military. If you don't, then I'm still sorry for you, because they have protected this great country ever since its beginning. Think of the guys in that very beginning wars, when we got our independence. You know, through the winter, they didn't have shoes a lot of times. You could track them in the snow with the blood from their feet. Now you think about wanting to go home. Yes. And they just didn't. They stayed. And here we have one great country on this planet Earth. Now, I have a poem here in my hand that I'd like to read to you. It's my prayer for America. Now, I want you to listen to these words. Think about the words of it. Pay a lot of attention to these words, because I have no idea what is going on in our country at this time. Today, our flag was waving. My eyes were dimmed with tears. Another war beginning brought back so many years. Once more, an evil monster had raised his ugly head, and many innocent people will soon be lying dead. This lovely country, crowded with people, folks of every race, afraid to go about their life, afraid to show their face. There will always be evil people who only live to hate, but love is stronger, and we must trust each while we wait. To see the sun arising and changing off the rain, and pray our God will help us live a good life again. I've seen the face of evil many times before, and my heart is filled with sadness to behold it all once more. Dear God, please help the good men and women who are serving this our great country now, and give them help in every way. My head to thee I bow. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. All right. Now, all of you know that I'm Bill.
Please join us as we sing.
Bless the name.
Well, let's have the children come up. I think the count was three, and I saw three. So if the kids want to come join me for a children's moment. High five. That was awesome. Are you coming, Reed? How are you today? Good. Well, I'm glad you're good. Well, I got to thinking about this weekend, and it's about the military and remember them. And they wear armor, don't they, to keep themselves safe? Yeah. Well, did you know that in the Bible, God talks about us wearing armor? What do you think the armor is he asks us to wear? You don't know? What do you think? You got any ideas? No? Well, in Ephesians 6, verse 11, he talks about standing firm then. This is from Paul. And he tells us that we should wear a belt of truth buckled around our waist and a breastplate of righteousness in place, with our feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to this, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And so what it got me thinking about is that we're constantly in a battle with whether we're going to choose to do the right thing for God or the wrong thing. And one of the ways that we can really be prepared is making sure that every day we talk to God. He's like our commander, so we need to make sure to check in with him and talk with him each day. And we want to stay in the word because it helps us know and prepare what we need to have in our heart, so that sometime we might meet a friend who doesn't know God and we can bring him to Jesus with us. So those were some things I was thinking about, and I just thought I would share them with you. And so now can we bow our heads and maybe say a little prayer? Here we go. Dear Lord, thank you for this time to be together, and that we know that ultimately we are here to further your kingdom. And we just pray, Lord, that you give us the tools that we need and the armor to wear so that we can always be for you and always be advancing your word. For it's in your holy and precious name we pray these things. Amen. All right, thanks for coming with us.
Good morning, church. This morning, we come with open hearts, open minds. Pastor Kathleen is out this week, and annual conference is next week, so I believe she'll be out next week as well. We will have the Bob family here next week to share their testimony and their experiences with their mission in Cambodia. So if you can mark that on your calendar, and for those that are online, if you'd like to watch that as well, maybe I could switch this on, it might work a little better.
3, 2, 1, there we go. I put it on my ear, I just didn't turn on the box. But it is welcoming to see so many smiling faces this morning. As we continue, we also continue our offering. The plates are located in the back on your way out. For those of you that are not with us this morning and online, there are ways, of course, to give, as well as our link on our Facebook page and at BainbridgeUnitedMethodistChurch.com. And if you could take care of the tithing, I'm sure that it will be used in very needed ways. To churches in our district that we normally pray for each week, we have a two-church charge down in, I believe it's Adams County, and it's called Liberty Chapel. One of those is located in West Union, and the other one is located at Scrubs Ridge. And the pastor's name is Alicia Schaefer. So if you could lift those two churches, that two-church charge up in your prayers this week, I'm sure they would greatly appreciate that. We have a big celebration in town tomorrow. I'm sure you noticed today on your way in on Main Street, on the light poles in town, all the veterans' flags that have been erected. That's awesome. I wish they can't be real big, but if they were just a little bit bigger. But I think the best way to be to observe them is just to park your car and walk up and down the street. Get a little exercise in and acknowledge each and every one of them. I think it's real cool down this way that Peachy and Paul Martin are on the same light pole. That's awesome. Husband and wife team serving in our armed forces and recognized on those flags. But if you do get a chance, either today or tomorrow, I'm sure they're going to be up for a while, but if you have a chance to get around and take in those, I think that would be awesome.
Excuse me a minute.
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
They also run out 41 on that street also. Is that Quarry?
Oh. Down Quarry Street?
Yes.
Okay.
Oh,
okay. So they're on that on Quarry Street as well. Okay, cool. I mean, it's an awesome tribute for the community to put those up and recognize the veterans that we have that are serving, not only here in the village of Bainbridge, but in the surrounding areas. Also, continuing on that theme, tomorrow is one of the biggest events that happen in downtown, beautiful downtown Bainbridge. Of course, it's the Memorial Day Parade. I'll give you some particulars on it. The lineup will be at the corner of Maple and 3rd Street at 1:45. So if you've got a bicycle, a tricycle, a wagon, I think there might be a golf cart or two around town that you could decorate in some kind of patriotic fashion and gather at the corner of Maple and 3rd at 1:45. The parade, 1:30, the parade will commence at 1:45 and culminate up at the cemetery for a 2 p.m. memorial service by the local VFW that conducts this. Is that correct, Brother Bill?
Legion.
American Legion. Our local American Legion in town will conduct a public ceremony at 2 p.m. at the cemetery for our fallen veterans. Is there anything else that I'm missing? I try to write all this down and I get home and I think, oh man, I wish I said something about that. Anyway, last week, Pastor Kathleen spoke on the fact that the Holy Spirit empowers us to share the story of Jesus. The Holy Spirit empowers us to reach out, to take the story of Jesus beyond these walls and share it with our fellow man. Today, I would like to focus on when God speaks to us in the several different ways that God does speak to us. And I'd like to begin with prayer. Heavenly Father, we gather this morning in this beautiful sanctuary to hear the words spoken through me to our congregation. Father God, we just ask that you open our hearts and open our minds to receive these words, to receive the teachings and the scripture that you've laid upon my heart this morning. Father God, as we continue to be more like Jesus, help guide our walk. Help give us the grace and mercy that we don't deserve, but yet we receive openly. Father, we ask all these things in thy precious Son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen. Scripture this morning comes from the book of 1 Samuel, chapter 3, verses 1 through 10. Now the boy Samuel was serving the Lord under Eli. The Lord's word was rare at that time, and the visions weren't widely known. One day, Eli, whose eyes had grown so weak that he was unable to see, was lying down in his room. God's lamp hadn't gone out as of yet, and Samuel was lying down in the Lord's temple. The Lord called to Samuel, "I am here," he said. Samuel hurried to Eli and said, "I'm here, you called me." "I didn't call you," Eli replied. "Go lie down." So Samuel did. Again the Lord called to Samuel. Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "I'm here, you called me." "I didn't call you, my son," Eli replied. "Go and lie down." Now Samuel didn't yet know the Lord, and the Lord's word hadn't been yet revealed to him. A third time the Lord called Samuel. He got up and went to Eli and said, "I'm here. You called me." Then Eli realized that it was the Lord who was calling the boy. So Eli said to Samuel, "Go and lie down. If he calls you again, say, 'Speak, Lord, your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down where he had been. The Lord came and stood there, calling just as before, "Samuel, Samuel." Samuel said, "Speak, Lord, your servant is listening." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Today we are continuing our series on hearing God, and we want to look at the different ways God speaks to us. God created each one of us in a unique and different ways. He's given us different gifts. He's given us different abilities. And he's blessed us with different temperaments. We have different styles of learning and different ways of expressing and receiving love. It should not be surprising that when each one of us hears from God, we hear differently. God does speak. Now one way, then maybe another. Though we may not receive or we may not be able to perceive what God is currently speaking to us. But he does speak to us in different ways. The question is whether or not we are able to receive it and hear him. God was speaking to young Samuel, but Samuel didn't recognize his voice. I think this is a story for many of us. God is speaking to us, but we simply do not know yet how to hear or how to understand it. So what are some of the ways that God speaks to us today? Number one, it's an out loud, audible voice. Sometimes God will speak to us in an audible voice. This is how God spoke to Samuel in the Old Testament. He called out his name audibly. This also is how Jesus spoke to Paul in the New Testament. He spoke out in a loud way that Saul could understand. We read in the book of Acts, chapter 9, 3 and 4, that as Saul neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" Throughout the Bible and history, there have been many people who have heard God's audible voice. "This has never happened to me." Though there have been times that God's voice was so clear that it almost seemed audible. Years ago, there was a psychologist named Tanya Thurman who wrote a book, When God Talks Back, Understanding the American Evangelical Relationship Between God. She appeared on CNN and made fun of Christians who claimed to have heard God's voice. In her book, she said that studies have shown that around 10% of evangelicals claim that they have heard God's voice in an audible voice. I don't know how accurate that is, but certainly one of the ways God still speaks to us today is in a loud and audible voice. My sister Vicki said sometimes she hears it through a megaphone, it's so loud. The second way God speaks to us is by angels. God speaks to us through angels. The word angel comes from the Greek word angelos, which means messenger. Angels bring us messages from God. Angels appeared to Abraham, Lot, Jacob, Moses, Gideon, Samson's mother and father, David, Elijah, Mary, and Joseph, the shepherds, Jesus, Philip, Peter, Paul, and John. Angels bring us messages from God. We read in the books of Acts, chapter 8, 26 through 27, "Now the angel of the Lord said to Philip, 'Go south to the road, the desert road that goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza.' So he started out, and on his way, he made an Ethiopian eunuch." There are also many historical accounts of angels coming to speak God messages to men and women. John Patton was a missionary in the New Hebrides Islands. One night, hostile natives surrounded the mission station, intent on burning out the Paytons and killing them. Payton and his wife prayed during the terror-filled night that God would deliver them. When daylight came, they were amazed to see that their attackers had left. A year later, the chief of the tribe was converted to Christ. Remembering what had happened, Payton asked the chief what had kept them from burning down the house and killing them. The chief replied in surprise, "Who were all those men with you there?" Payton knew that no men were present, but the chief said he was afraid to attack because he had seen hundreds of big men with shining garments and drawn swords circling the mission station. Other way God speaks to us is through the supernatural. God spoke to Moses through a burning bush, and he spoke to Balaam through a talking donkey. God used the hand writing on the wall to communicate the judgment to King Belshazzar, and he used the fleece to prove his word to Gideon. God refuses his limit and limits himself only one way of communicating. He can use any means he wishes. He can use anything or any means he wishes. And by doing so, he confirms his word and his will for our lives. Years ago, there was a worship leader named Graham Kendrick who wrote the songs like "Shine, Jesus, Shine." I remember one time we were at a concert up in Hillsboro, and I knew I should have wrote it down. The musician that was playing at the time stopped in the middle of the concert, just stopped it, and said, "You need to listen to the words of the song. You need to listen to the message of the song and focus on what's being said, not what's being sung. Focus on what's being said and not what's being sung." God stepped in and said, "Listen to what you are singing," and spoke to that musician that night. God still speaks today out loud. He speaks through angels, and he speaks through miracles. A fourth way that God speaks to us is through other people. We read about the gifts of the Spirit, and we see that there are gifts given by God to communicate his truth throughout and with the body of Christ. This includes prophecy, words of knowledge, words of wisdom, words of encouragement, and words of criticism. God still speaks to us today out loud. He speaks through angels, through miracles, and through other people. A fifth way that God speaks to us is through dreams and visions. A dream is when God speaks to you when you are asleep, and a vision is when God speaks to you when you are awake. Generally, these are visual images communicating God's word and his will to us. God still speaks to us out loud, through angels, through miracles, through other people, and through our minds. And last and finally, God speaks to us in his still, small voice. It's when God gives you a sense or a tug or a move in a certain direction or direction. I remember Pastor Scott used to reference his two before moments. God would smack him upside the head with a two before. God gives you these senses to move us in a certain direction. There are times when I've just sensed that God was saying something to me. Sometimes it includes an image, but not always. It's a prompting, like, though it does not go away, just kind of keeps nudging, and you just feel that tug or that kind of swift kick in the little backside or whatever, you know, get up and do this. God's still small voice is sometimes a whisper, small, quiet, personal. That means it can be easily missed or overlooked. Often when we wish that God would speak to us, he could use a megaphone, that the clouds would part and a trumpet would sound and the lightning would flash and the thunder would crash. But usually it's a small whisper or a nudge. 1 Kings 19:11. The Lord said, "Go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountains apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake. The Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake came a fire, but the Lord was not in a fire. After the fire came a gentle whisper. When Elijah heard it, he pulled his cloak over his face and went out and stood at the mouth of the cave. Then a voice said to him, "Elijah, what are you doing here?" God chose not to speak in the wind or the earthquake or the fire, but he chose a whisper. Why do you think he chose that method? Because a whisper requires us to listen closely. If something isn't loud, you just try to shut it out. I know when an emergency squad goes by anymore, I got to cover my ear. These things are so loud. But however, when somebody whispers to you, it means you have to kind of lean in close and actively listen in order to understand. God wants to speak to us today. He will try to speak to us out loud, through angels, through miraculous signs, and through other people. He will also use his still small voice. Are we listening? There are times in my life when I have failed to hear what God was trying to tell me. When that happened, he would often increase the volume until my life became very uncomfortable. He does that because he loves us. I've heard this quote before. A man can never be the same after hearing God's voice spoken in the power of the Holy Spirit. He will either obey it and go forward or ignore and die just a little. A good pilot does what it takes to get his passengers home. I heard the story of a flight that was heading into some very rough weather. The captain turned on the fasten seatbelt light, indicated that everyone should take their seats, but no one paid attention to it. So the flight attendants came through and told everyone to take their seats, put on their seatbelts because of impending turbulence. However, this was a rowdy flight. People were on vacation and not quick to respond. She warned them again, "The flight is about to get very bumpy. For your own safety, please take your seats." Some did, but some still did not. So she changed her tone of voice a little. "Ladies and gentlemen, for your own good, take your seats now." And finally, when it seemed that everyone had taken their seats, the voice of the pilot come on the intercom. "This is the captain speaking. People have gotten hurt by walking around and going to the bathroom instead of staying in your seats. Let me be very clear about our responsibilities. My job is to get you through this storm. Your job is to do what I say. Now sit down and buckle up." Good pilots do what it takes to get their passengers home. So does God. So here's a question for you. How far do you want God to go into getting your attention? If God has to choose between your eternal safety, and your earthly comfort, which do you think he's going to choose? Don't answer too quickly. Give it some thought. God will whisper. God will shout. God will touch and hug. He will take away our burdens, but he will also take away our blessings. God's goal is not to make you happy. His goal is to make you his. God's goal is not to make us happy. His goal is to make us his. His goal is not to let you get what you want. His goal is to get you what you need. So learn to hear his voice. Obey it. And respond when he speaks to you. Let's pray. Father God, we ask that when you speak to us, may we be open. May we be attentive. And may we be ready to listen and hear that still small voice, that tug or that push, that word of encouragement from a friend, the word of prayer. Father God, as we leave this place, may we be open to your voice. Continue us to light, to shine amongst those who are searching and seeking you. May we be that vehicle that brings someone to the light that you provide for all of us. And all these things we pray. Amen.
Please stand for our last hymn.
Sweet land of liberty.
getting my steps in this morning. I'd like to leave you this word. As we exit today, may God lift up the light of his countenance upon you all, give you peace, and never keep you from falling. Amen.